King Lear by William Shakespeare. Introduced by Richard Eyre.
A play that appears to be about everything can be daunting, but not the least of the marvels of King Lear lies in its accessibility. It's a symphonic variation on the theme of love. Family love, parental love, brotherly love, sisterly love, sexual love. Love flouted, love refused, love suppressed, love unrequited. King Lear is about family, about fathers and their children, about children and their fathers. There are two fathers in the play, Lear and Gloucester, one with three daughters, the other with two sons. Both receive a brutal education in parental love. Both are made to see through blindness, real and metaphorical. The play moves with a vertiginous speed, descending breathlessly into disaster, which gives it a plausible familiarity. We've all sat down to a family meal that has declined from geniality to savagery before the pudding's been put on the table. And it ends with a domestic holocaust, the stage piled with the corpses of the whole family. What have we learned? That our fate lies in ourselves. What's the play about? It's about being alive and becoming dead, about the smell of mortality and the mystery of things, about being human.
King Lear by William Shakespeare, with Corin Redgrave as King Lear, Geraldine James as Goneril, Kika Markham as Regan, Justine Waddell as Cordelia, John Carlyle as Gloucester, David Troughton as Kent, Robert Glenister as Edgar, William Houston as Edmund, Clive Francis as Cornwall, John Rowe as Albany, and Paul Copley as the Fool, with music specially composed by Elizabeth Parker. King Lear.
I thought the king had more affected the Duke of Albany than Cornwall.
It had always seemed so to us. But now, in the division of the kingdom, it appears not which of the dukes he values most.
Is not this your son, my lord?
His breeding, sir, hath been in my charge. I have so often blushed to acknowledge him that now I am raised to it.
I cannot conceive you.
Sir, this young fellow's mother could. Whereupon she grew round-wound and had indeed, sir, a son for her cradle as she had a husband for her bed. And do you smell a fault?
I cannot wish the fault undone, the issue of it being so proper.
But I have a son, sir, by order of law, some year elder than this, who yet is no dearer in my account. Though this knave came something saucily to the world before he was sent for, yet was his mother fair. There was good sport at his making, and the whore son must be acknowledged. Do you know this noble gentleman, Edmund?
No, my lord.
My lord of Kent. Remember him hereafter as my honourable friend.
My services to your lordship.
I must love you, and see you to know you better.
Sir, I shall study discernment.
He's been out 9 years, and away he shall again. Yeah, the king is coming.
Attend the lords of France and Burgundy, Gloucester.
I shall, my liege.
Meantime, we shall express our darker purpose. Give me the map there. Know that we have divided in three our kingdom, and 'tis our fast intent to shake all cares and business from our age, conferring them on younger strengths, while we, unburthened, crawl towards death. Our son of Cornwall, and you, our no less loving son of Albany, we have this hour a constant will to publish our daughter's several dowers, that future strife may be prevented now. The princes, France and Burgundy, great rivals in our youngest daughter's love, long in our court have made their amorous sojourn, and here are to be answered. Tell me, my daughters, since now we will divest us both of rule, interest of territory, cares of state, which of you, shall we say, doth love us most? that we, our largest bounty, may extend where nature doth with merit challenge. Goneril, our eldest born, speak first.
Sir, I love you more than words can wield the matter. Dearer than eyesight, space and liberty. Beyond what can be valued, rich or rare. No less than life, with grace, health, beauty, honour. As much as child e'er loved or father found. A love that makes breath poor and speech unable. Beyond all manner of so much, I love you.
What shall Cordelia do? Love, and be silent.
Of all these bounds, even from this line to this, with shadowy forests and with champaigns rich with plenteous rivers and wide-skirted meads, we make thee, lady, to thine and Albany's issue be this perpetual. What says our second daughter, our dearest Regan, wife to Cornwall? Speak.
Sir, I am made of the selfsame metal that my sister is, and prize me at her worth. In my true heart, I find she names my very deed of love. Only she comes too short. That I profess myself an enemy to all other joys which the most precious square of sense possesses, and find I am alone felicitate in your dear highness love.
Then poor Cordelia, and yet not so, since I am sure my love's more richer than my tongue.
To thee and thine hereditary ever remain this ample third of our fair kingdom, no less in space, validity, and pleasure than that conferred on Goneril. Now, our joy, although the last, not least, to whose young love the vines of France and milk of Burgundy strive to be interest, what can you say? To draw a third more opulent than your sister's? Speak.
Nothing, my lord.
Nothing?
Nothing.
Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy that I am, I cannot heave my heart into my mouth. I love your majesty according to my bond. No more, nor less.
How? Cordelia, mend your speech a little, lest it may mar your fortunes.
Good, my lord. You have begot me, bred me, loved me. I return those duties back as our right fit. Obey you, love you, and most honour you. Why have my sisters husbands if they say they love you all? Happily, when I shall wed that lord whose hand must take my plight, shall carry half my love with him, half my care and duty. Sure, I shall never marry like my sisters to love my father all.
But goes thy heart with this?
Aye, good my lord.
So young, and so untender.
So young, my lord, and true.
Let it be so. Thy truth, then, be thy dower. For by the sacred radiance of the sun, the mysteries of Hecate, and the night, by all the operation of the orbs from which we do exist and cease to be, here I disclaim all my paternal care, propinquity and property of blood, and as a stranger to my heart and me, hold thee from this forever. The barbarous Scythian, or he that makes his generation messes to gorge his appetite, shall to my bosom be as well neighbored, pitied, and relieved as thou, my sometime daughter.
Good, my liege.
Oh, peace, Kent. Come not between the dragon and his wrath. I loved her most, and thought to set my rest on her kind nursery. Hence, and avoid my sight, so be my grave my peace, as here I give her father's heart from her. Call France. Who sir? Call Burgundy. Cornwall. And Albany.
Sir.
Let my two daughters digest this third. Let pride, which she calls plainness, marry her. I do invest you jointly with my power, preeminence, and all the large effects that troop with majesty. Ourself, by monthly course, with reservation of 100 knights. By you to be sustained, shall our abode make with you by due turns. Only, we still retain the name.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.